Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this EMBL webinar series entitled Lifelong Learning in the Biomedical Sciences. My name is Mike Hardman, and I'm one of the scientific organizers. So today's webinar is entitled to prepare and incentivize research scientists and healthcare professionals for collaborative innovation. And I'm delighted to introduce our two speakers, Michel Goldman and Hilde Stevens. I'm sure a number of you will know them. Michel was formerly executive director of the Innovative Medicines Initiative, where I got to know him. And he then moved back to academia and set up the I3h, where he's founder and co-director, and also professor of immunology and pharmacotherapy at the Université Libre de Bruxelles. And Hilde is a senior researcher and lecturer at the I3h, and she has the chair in translational medicine at the Institute. So we have two very eminent speakers who have a whole range of experience, which will be very relevant as far as today's presentation is concerned. So I'll pass over to Michel and Hilde and put myself on mute, and then I'll come back at the end when we go through the questions.
So good afternoon, good morning, or good evening, wherever you are around the world, because you know we know that we have many people in different places. It's a real pleasure to spend this hour with you to discuss why more than ever we need to prepare the healthcare actors, stakeholders, to collaborate more in order to foster innovation. So what I will do in the first part of this webinar is to explain you why, and then Hilde Stevens will let you know what we at I3h are have done to indeed prepare this new generation, which is so critical to move different aspects of healthcare forward. So let's start. Okay, I will start by introducing this concept of precision medicine. I'm sure that you all know that this concept is really, in a way, revolutionizing the way healthcare is delivered. I'm sure that you are aware of the Precision Medicine Initiative that was launched by Barack Obama just before the end of his mandate as President of the United States. So the concept is the following, and as we speak today, it's mainly applied in the field of cancer in oncology. You know, until recently, a few years ago, in most cases of cancer, you identify the target tissue or the target organ, let's say the lung, and in most cases, the same type of treatment, let's say chemotherapy, would be given to all patients with the same lung cancer, identified, let's say, by histology, by pathology. And the results of that was that in some patients it works fine, in others, unfortunately, there is no effect, and even in other groups, you might see adverse reactions. And the reason is that we know that when you make the diagnosis of lung cancer, actually you include under this diagnosis an heterogeneous group of patients with different forms of cancer. If you look, for example, at the molecular basis of the cell proliferation. So the concept of precision medicine is really to stratify those patient population using biomarkers, which mean blood analysis or analysis of the tumor, especially looking at genetic abnormalities in the tumor, using imaging techniques, and they are more and more sophisticated. And by combining all this information using appropriate algorithms, you will be able to stratify the patients suffering from this cancer in different groups. And according to each group, you will be able to define a specific treatment which will result in a positive effect in all patients. So that's really the principle. Now, what's very important is to realize first that this type of precision medicine will be applied more and more, not only to different types of cancer, but also to other disease. Think about inflammatory disease or neurological or neurodegenerative disease. And just to make the point, just think that in many diseases, you use the name of the physician or the scientist who discovered the disease to qualify a collection of symptoms. And actually, this doesn't tell you anything about the real basic root of the disease, which actually will differ in one patient to the other. For example, in Crohn's disease, you have a purely genetic form of the inflammation, of the gut inflammation, whereas in other cases, it's the environment which is responsible, the microbiome, etc. And the same in Alzheimer's. We know that in certain cases, the genetic background is critical. In other cases, there are other factors which play a dominant role. The second point I would like to make is that in all this situation, and I gave you a few examples, I could have had asthma, actually, more and more, we have to look big data approaches in order to combine the information derived for all these different analyses. I mentioned blood analysis. This is very often using genetic or omics technology. And I also mentioned imaging and analysis of the tumor itself. And you have to integrate all this information, multiple information for the same patients, but also it's more and more important in order to identify the appropriate groups to combine data from high numbers of populations. So you immediately understand that you have to deal with large number of population to define the groups, and you have to deal with different data from multiple type of analysis for a single patient. So we really need big data tools, which at the end of the day will allow not only to identify what's the best treatment for the patient, but will also make you able to predict what will be the evolution of the disease in the patient. And this is what is shown on this cartoon. Now, the point I would like to make is that those informations, those data, are derived for the analysis I was mentioning, but also more and more, the patient, him or herself, will be the source of the data. And you all know the smart watches, and you already know that with these Apple watches, to give this example, you can already measure a number of parameters. I will not go into details, but obviously the cardiac rate, but also other cardiovascular parameters, and even the blood glucose using appropriate tools. Now, more and more, we will be able to record data not only from watches, but also from other devices that we will have on the body. So this means that more and more the patient will be an active, indeed making the diagnosis and even in developing the treatment. And this means also that when we will move from precision medicine to precision health, which means to be able to address the disease process very early on or even before it starts. And for this, you will combine the data I was just mentioning, but also you will be able to follow the lifelong risk in each patient. And again, the point I was making is that you will have to combine all these data and use sophisticated informatic tools, deep learning, machine learning to indeed analyze the relevant information that can be derived from all these techniques. And at the end of the day, those analyses will allow you to guide the treatment, to help the patient to take care of him or herself. And obviously, with this type of approach, you can think that telemedicine will also be extremely important. The goal being at the end of the day to spare as much as possible hospital bed, to avoid hospitalization as much as we can. Now, obviously, when you see all these developments, you realize that for a single individual, let's say for a single physician, it becomes really impossible to integrate all these data. And that's the reason why the revolution is also the more frequent use of artificial intelligence tools. This is an example developed by IBM, which, as you see on this cartoon, combined data from multiple sources and using this computerization technique, they are allowed to actually to make a diagnosis and to propose a treatment. And it was shown that for some type of disease, this might be as efficient or even more efficient than what a doctor can do. So this means that the professionals that will be involved in innovation and in taking care of patients in the future will be much different than what we see today. You know, today obviously we know the physician, the MD, and we all know the professions around this. But tomorrow, especially in the early steps following the discoveries and in this translation from discovery towards the bedside, the translation medicine, we will need new type of skills. We will need people skills in computation. We will need people skilled in different sophisticated technologies. When you see on this slide liquid biopsy, this means the sophisticated blood analysis, which already today could allow in some patients to identify that there is a cancer developing, and even using this blood analysis to suggest which is the organ affected. So on the right side, you see that also mathematicians, pure chemists, physicists, and obviously engineers will play more and more an important role in the development of precision medicine. The point I would like to also to make is that because we understand much better how chronic disease develop, and you know that chronic disease become more and more important for the patient, for the society, the economic burden is really growing, and we can think about disease like diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, Alzheimer, dementia, etc. And we know more and more that these diseases develop for different types of reasons, where the genetic background, the genome might be important, the microbiome might be very important. We know more and more that depending on the microbe and the microbial genes in our guts, we might be more prone, to develop certain disease and to react differently to certain treatments. Now, we also know that factors in the environment might have a profound action, both on the genome and on the microbiome. And I'm thinking about tobacco, alcohol, which, as you know, are very important causes of disease. Obviously, the diet is critical, not only sometimes in promoting obesity and diabetes, but also other type of disease. Recently, there's been a fascinating study showing that still sleep deprivation, even for a few days, can promote the accumulation of beta amyloid in the brain. And you know that beta amyloid accumulation is certainly involved in Alzheimer's dementia. Obviously, we know that drugs can have a profound effect, and a recent paper showed that, for example, non-antibiotics also influence the microbiome. Antibiotics, that's obvious, but a series of drugs, especially acting on the nervous system, can modify the microbiome. And obviously, the environment exposure, just think about, you know, those elements present in the environment modifying our endocrine system. These are just a few examples, but this is just to illustrate that, again, that the skills, even within the biomedical space, that we will need to move healthcare forward will be more and more diverse and involve different disciplines. I already mentioned translational medicine, which is really critical to translate results of basic research to the bedside. But there is more than that. It's not only that the drug is proved to be efficient and safe. After that, you have to see in which condition the drugs can reach the patients. There are a number of elements there, not only regulatory elements, but also economic elements. Just think about these new CAR T cell treatment, a combination of cell and gene therapy, which allow now to cure young children with acute leukemia, who are resistant to chemotherapy. It's about 10% of the cases. And before, those children were just dying. Now they can be cured through these therapies. That's very nice. Although the cost of these therapies is about $475,000 as we speak. This might change in the future, but there is a real problem of access to those innovative and most efficient treatments. So it means that we will also have to include in the healthcare landscape people with knowledge in public health, in health economics. And this explains why the number of jobs in the healthcare sector, in the healthcare industry, is indeed rising in a spectacular fashion, as you can see on this graph. And actually, as we speak, the healthcare sector is the sector for which the job opportunities are the most abundant. And that's why we have the importance to train those new professionals in the right way, to educate them about all these disciplines, but also to tell them that to be efficient in their work, more and more they will have to collaborate. Collective intelligence will be essential to move healthcare forward. And look at this statement by Elias Zerouni, who is a former director of the National Institute of Health in the United States, and who is currently the global R&D head of Sanofi. So, as Mike said, and probably some of you know, I was the first executive director of this unique public-private partnership, the Innovative Medicine Initiative, which in a way is still today the best example of how collaboration might be efficiently organized across the usual boundaries between the private and the public sector. And in this partnership, the pharmaceutical industry is investing. They invest a lot, 2.5 billion euros over this 15 years period. And this industry investment is matched by the investment of the European Union. And this investment is used to support partners of industry in the academic world within patients' organizations. And you understood that patients will have a more and more important role in healthcare delivery, small, medium-sized enterprise, regulatory agencies also receive funding from the European Union, And in a few months from now, you will be able to see the review which is undergoing to demonstrate the incredible achievements that were made possible through this partnership. Now, you have to collaborate, but within the collaboration, you have a very important role in making sure that the results derived from this collaboration are indeed accessible to the wider community. It means that transparency, dissemination is critical, but in order to have an efficient translation in health outcomes. But what is also critical is to make sure that results are reproducible. And we have to train the future professionals wherever they are in this space, because we have a problem there. If you look at the reliability of biomedical science today, the picture is not so nice. This is what is shown here. The number of retract paper in the medical literature is really quite important for a number of reasons, and it's really important to make sure that the experiments that are reported are conducted in the right way by the appropriate people. And that's again a collective responsibility to be sure of the quality of the research that is conducted. And that's especially a huge responsibility in the academic university sector. That's why, for example, when we were at IMI, we put some energy in promoting the use of standards in order to make sure that the data that are shared are of value. Now, I already mentioned the importance more and more to consider economic aspects. I could have spoken also about ethical aspects, social science, human science will become more and more important. And that's why we think that it's also important to train the healthcare professional of the future about this aspect. So what we are doing at I3h and what will be presented now by Hilde is really to develop, a system approach of training, which is in a way inspired by other initiatives that are shown here. This is the one conducted, I think, in Stanford or at Penn University. And the keywords there that will be further elaborated by Hilde now is interdisciplinarity. So this was my introduction. I will be happy to take questions later, and I now give the floor to Hilde.
Thank you, Michel. What we do at the I3h Institute is indeed focus and elaborate on this interdisciplinarity and this need for interdisciplinarity, really covering this journey, this multi-step iterative journey from the basic discovery in the lab, bringing this invention and making it an innovation, reaching the patient and giving access to this innovation for the patient. So going and really approaching it from a holistic approach, addressing these public health challenges, going from characterization of the disease towards target identification for intervention, seeing how to develop innovative health technologies, discussing how we can protect intellectually these developments, see how we set up new ventures, how we can raise capital to set up and to bring inventions to the patient. Also seeing and explaining and elaborating more on how to organize the industrial development, setting up clinical trials, and seeing how we can speed up this regulatory process, whereby increasingly the patient is involved. Going to this patient access, discussing risk-benefit assessments and the value for patients, and patient adherence, patient preferences. So we cover all the aspects in the whole cycle of drug development from a very broad perspective. So this is in the course, in the new way of educating the new or the next generation healthcare actors. There's a convergence of medicine, life cycle, physics, engineering, economics and management and humanities. And what is crucial in educating these new actors in the healthcare sector is that they have this interaction, they have this new way, or there is, or they that they get acknowledged with a new way of communicating with the different actors. And for this, we invite speakers and, well, actually experts all from all over the world coming to discuss with the participants in the program and interactively engage, coming from all over, such as regulatory agencies, such as the European Medicines Agency, health technology assessment agencies, NGOs, patient organizations, as this role is increasing for patients in the drug development cycle. UN representatives discussing the lessons learned, for example, from the HIV/AIDS epidemic, and of course, the academic excellence included in the teaching. So we hope to address people with various backgrounds, but all having an interest in the healthcare sector. And this includes not only the biomedical and the medical sciences, but also people with an engineering background, for example, bioengineers, biomedical engineers, chemical and materials engineering, people more involved in the public health sector, economists, management students, health law and regulation, both at the level of the master students, as well as PhDs, postdocs, and medical doctors in training, as well as young professionals being involved in various activities, but all related to innovation and healthcare. So what we really want to stress is that the future is changing. Healthcare innovation is needed, and lifelong learning will be the only way for you as scientists and next generation healthcare actors to maintain and further develop your competence to learn to communicate and interact with various disciplines and various actors. So thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Hilde. So I think that we have quite plenty of time for questions now, and I guess that Mike will coordinate this discussion.
Yes, first of all, thank you, Michel and Hilde, for an excellent presentation telling us about the changing world and in particular what your organization, I3h, is doing to address that. The first of the questions actually came through in advance of the meeting, so I'll read that one out. And that one was really asking the principles that you've described, saying in which fields can those principles best be applied? So I'll leave it to the two of you to decide who wants to answer that particular question.
The question is about the fields where this new concept will apply. This is your question, Mike?
Yes, that's the question. So I'm assuming the fields mean the different sort of technical fields, scientific fields. You've talked very much about medical sciences. So maybe you'd like to say how broadly that applies.
Well, I think that as I said, it starts in the oncology fields. Me to give a concrete example with the idea that different drugs can be given to patients with different mutations in their tumor. And actually this makes the cancer research more complicated because in a way even common cancers become rare disease as soon as you start to stratify the patients. So that's why, interestingly enough, another skill that I didn't mention is about the design of clinical trial. For example, now instead of making trials, let's say in lung cancer, what is done is to use the same trial to test treatments in different cancers, but with the same mutation. And this proved to be quite efficient. But I think it's very important, and I have no time to elaborate on this, to understand that the same concept will apply to many other diseases. I didn't mention asthma, but for example, as we speak, severe asthma can very often benefit from target therapy, biotherapy, which actually allow to reduce the hospitalization for this condition by about 50%. So it will be broad in terms of competencies that will be required to make all these things happening. I think that I mentioned them. The point I would like to make is that competencies in educating patients about taking care on them, of themselves, patients and obviously caregivers, will become more and more important. I mean, there's been a recent article in the Economist, I think it was the front page, saying, okay, the doctor will become yourself. So I think that to educate people will also become very important. So you see, there is a broad range of skills and discipline. But the point I didn't make and I want to make now is that we think that you need the basic knowledge across the different disciplines to understand what people in the innovation chain before you and after you are doing, to understand how your partners in taking care of the same patients are working and the things that they have to take into consideration. Because at the end of the day, all this is a teamwork. The patient is at the center, but there are, as I said, a number of skills, discipline around which are required. And I think it's important to understand what your partner is doing in the collaboration. And that's really, I would say, the main objective of the main course that we are launching now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Michel. The next question I'll read out relates to big data. It says, research in precision medicine is a great endeavor, but depends on big data. How can the requirement for collecting and storing big data be combined with protection of data privacy? Particularly important nowadays, given the new European data privacy law, which becomes effective as of next month. So would you like to comment on that one?
Yeah, as you know, Mike, we can have a 2 days workshop on this critical question. There is a new directive which is now enforced, or which will be enforced in a few weeks in Europe, the 25th of May. Hilde tells me. So this will certainly change the landscape, perhaps make a few things more difficult. But it gives me the opportunity, and perhaps I didn't emphasize this enough, that indeed competencies, not only in ethics, but also in those questions of how do you protect data privacy will be important. So it's clear that more and more law school will become important for these aspects, as well as for the aspect of intellectual property along the innovation change. So I think that you are raising a very important question. But again, it's very important that, for example, the clinician who is directly in contact with patients in trials have the knowledge of the concept which underlies these data privacy protection policies and guidelines.
Okay, thank you very much. As you say, a huge topic, particularly given the recent changes, and we're all learning how to deal with that. The next question says, what about the incentives for, sorry, I'll have to scroll as I read this, for all to keep learning? and talks about a need for incentive because this continuous learning process is obviously going to be something which is, as we described, you know, lifelong, and there's no other way to do that. So incentives for continuous lifelong learning.
That's really a very important question, and thank you very much for raising this question. I think that this question of incentives is really critical. And actually, as we speak, we like appropriate incentives to have people collaborating efficiently. We lack incentives for industry to invest in some badly needed drugs. We lack incentives for scientists to really pay attention to the potential applications of their research. So I think that, and we lack incentives for hospitals, which have a critical role in translational research. But if you look at the way, at least in my country and around, the hospitals are funded, we don't have the appropriate incentives for promoting translational research. So it's just that this question of incentives is critical. And I think that the answer is that we need incentives for the different stakeholders, and I mentioned them, I will not repeat them. And those incentives will then provide incentives to the professionals. And I'm sure this will come because in their KPIs, the stakeholders, but also the professional within, each company or within each public institution will have clearly a KPI about the way they ensure their continuous education, because this will be part of the way we also assess the excellence and the performance of the institution or company they are working for. So, but for the time being, I think that in the main incentive would be that if people want to do their job correctly, they should understand what we just tried to explain with Hilde, the need to follow the advances in their sectors, but also outside their sectors. And for this, indeed, professional continuous education is critical. But I think that Hilde would like to add a few things.
Well, regarding this, I would say that from an educational point of view, in Belgium, they are really looking towards sustainable education. And one example there I could say is that, for example, they are discussing and they have guidelines to see whether this reward system can be incentivized to really stimulate interdisciplinary and cross and transdisciplinary learning, not only focusing, for example, on academic excellence in the number of publications or the number of patents filed by a specific department, but also in how interdisciplinary teams are set up and how research is translated between different research groups. So this is really something that is now being developed and more, incentivized, but already from early on, and not only higher education, but they try to really, take this project-based learning and collaborative efforts from the primary school, we can say. But continuous learning, it needs to be more incentivized, and people should be aware that team science will be needed to innovate healthcare.
Okay, thank you very much, Michel and Hilde. There's another question which is related to that, but I think takes it a little bit more broadly, and is, what is your advice to how to embrace the entire healthcare community in Europe, globally, at least on the broader scale, and make sure they understand the new approaches and how properly to deal with them. So maybe this relates not just to academia, but everybody involved in the healthcare systems.
Thank you again for this question. This is a real challenge. And actually, that's why we try to focus more and more on our activities. Actually, before people enter the professional career, we think that we have to start this very early on. Actually, that's why we really target master students and young PhD students, because we think that at this level of their career, they are more receptive to not only to understand why this is needed, but also to include this collaborative, to adopt this collaborative mindset. Sorry. Would you like to add something?
Well, just that indeed, this requires various disciplines, because it's not only medical doctors who will end up curing the patient. It really will involve, and it already involves, a number of skills, and that's not only academic skills, but also the patient. Well, the patient is always in the center, but patient organizations as well, they lack, and they really request this training, that they can communicate with various regulatory agencies and health technology assessment agencies, that can be involved, and that their preferences can be taken into account when setting up clinical research, and when discussing how pricing and reimbursement and new financial models can bring these new and innovative therapies to the patient and make it affordable and sustainable for all. So it's really a question of addressing the various skills and the various type of people. And indeed, as Michel already said, this has to start already in the, well, at the very basic level of the bachelor's and the master programs at the universities and the high schools.
Okay, thank you very much, both of you. I guess we're building on that theme here. There's another question, which is, how can an individual best keep him or herself informed of the future skills needs? You've described very well what you're doing and some of the other examples, Hilde, you mentioned in Belgium, but overall, how does a scientist, wherever he or she is working, get information about future skills needs?
Well, my short answer would be that by following the MBL webinars. I think that...
Thank you.
No, but I think that there are currently a number of initiatives which are accessible online, and I'm thinking about our colleagues, you know, in countries in Africa or in Asia. I think that now all these tools are quite efficient. Actually, ourselves, we are developing a system of video conference which are interactive, which is quite important. So I think that this will be more and more developed and accessible everywhere. And I think that, you know, with all the new tools, and obviously the social media, and I would say by following the I3h website, we are very keen to upload on our website all information about initiative, incentivizing for to follow this type of trainings.
Absolutely, and I would add to this that it's not only for academic and highly trained profiles that you can continuously learn about how you can play a role in the drug development cycle. It's also, for example, if you are a representative of a patient organization or an individual patient, that there are so many tools available. For example, and I refer to the EPATI toolboxes that are available, especially made available through this IMI effort, which is EPATI. and they are made available by the national platforms in various languages. So even if you are not medically or biomedically skilled, you can train yourself and you can continuously learn how to play and how to engage into this healthcare innovation landscape.
Thank you, Hilde. For those of you who might not be aware of the UPATI program, then you can certainly find information on their website. And as we've heard, if the focus is more on the patients and the patients are aware and driving this, then that's another mechanism by which the, all of the healthcare professionals will get the information from various sources. There's another question here. Michel, you mentioned, I think it was one of the publications that you mentioned from the US. Is there anything else specifically in the US which is similar to what you're doing in I3h to promote this sort of collaborative work that you're describing?
Well, I think that perhaps Hilde, who had a look at the Stanford initiative, can make a few comments.
There's indeed the Stanford initiative, which also really focuses on interdisciplinary learning. There are various programs, but then, in my opinion, they are more directed towards biomedical and medically trained or paramedically trained profiles. But there are in the US, well, actually, our efforts are inspired on Harvard programs in translational medicine. There are indeed various initiatives. And as far as I know in Europe, well, going beyond the biomedical and medical trained people, I think that we have this unique offer of providing this interdisciplinary program, well, actually to all those that are interested in healthcare innovation.
Let me perhaps give you one example, which I think is quite striking. One of our partners at I3h is really a top-notch economist. His name is Mathias de Watripon. And what they came to us and said, did you see what's happening in the US with this opioid crisis? It's unbelievable. You know, for the first year, the life expectancy in the US is decreasing because the number, I think, 50,000 deaths of opioid overdose. And then, you know, we explored together what was the cause of this, and there are many causes, one of which being the aggressive marketing strategies of the manufacturers of some of the drugs. And obviously, when we discuss this with the students, we go from the analysis of the roots of the crisis, and then we go on, we discuss how can we address the crisis with, you know, the drug which can, in a way or another, alleviate addiction and all these things. And we discussed, for example, the parallel that these economists found between the opioid crisis and the bank crisis in 2008. And I think that especially for young people, it opens their mind and they learn to put all these questions in a broad perspective while still being educated about how to address the issue and how to take care of the patients. So that's just one example, and I can give you others about how we address this question. Obviously, vaccination, especially the question of how to increase vaccine coverage. Just think about, you know, the resurgence of measles in our countries, the problem of making sure that vaccine coverage is sufficient to provide vaccine access in emerging countries, with the problem of the cold chain, all these things. But we usually start with a simple question, which is, in this case, how can we best leverage on the vaccine efficacy? And we start by telling them that if each year we save 9 million of lives around the world through vaccination. But we can do 1 million more if we would be able to ensure an adequate coverage. And then we discuss about vaccine technologies, the new vaccines and all these things. And yeah, that's what we are doing.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me just say, Michel, and to Hilde, whereas people were saying they needed to be aware of it, you've certainly made them aware of what's happening in the world. Whereas people were saying, how do they find out what can be done and how to support that? You've given us some very nice examples, both from your own institute and from other parts of the world. And indeed, as you mentioned, the EMBL webinar series in lifelong learning was set up to provide this information for people so that there is somewhere for people to go so that they can get information from the speakers that we've had. So I think with that, then we'll draw today's webinar to a close. Let me thank on your behalf, both Michel and Hilde for bringing, I think, a very exciting view of what's going on and also a very pragmatic way of how they're dealing with that and how others can be dealing with that. So with that, we'll call it this the end of the webinar. So thank you to our speakers. Thank you to everyone else who's partaken in today's webinar, and to my colleagues, including Claire, who's been managing everything in the background for us. So thank you, everybody. Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.